The modernist period begins with the end of World War I and is generally considered to end with the worldwide market collapse and depression that began in 1929. Like any period, the artistic movement known as modernism, in whatever art one chooses to pull examples from, is defined by those characteristics which separate it from the period that came before. The 19th century had already seen tremendous change throughout Europe and the world. European imperial nations spread their colonies as far as they could, gobbling up South Asia, the Middle East, Africa, and portions of South America. European aggression and military capacity made Europe the center of any events large enough to be considered world events during this time period. When the war began in 1914, it marked the end of a period of 47 years of relative peace between the great powers of Europe, and the first time that they'd gone to war as militaries from fully industrialized nations. The trench warfare of World War I saw the first use of modern artillery, the first use of the machine gun, the first use of chemical weapons, the first use of airplanes, and the first use of tanks. Europe in particular had marched along under the banner of progress since the beginning of the Renaissance, and had believed that with logic and enough time, things would inevitably improve. And Europe had seen a number of cultural revolutions occur during the 19th century. We saw the end of slavery across Europe, the expansion of the vote in many nations, the Industrial Revolution, and the change to a capitalist economy, the continued development of modern science, including culturally shattering claims from Darwin and others that seemed to push human beings out of their traditional place as the center of the universe. Across Europe, industry meant that while farms were more productive and efficient than ever, there were fewer and fewer jobs needed in agriculture and rural areas. Cities were flooded. The average person in England was a factory worker. Meanwhile, despite the expansion of the vote, the old birth-based class structure, while more fluid, continued with its inherent inequalities and supposition of special rights for the privileged few. Thus, as we enter the modern period, people's lives had largely been transformed from what they'd been 47 years ago, when last there had been a conflict between major European powers. The intellectual elite were already moving toward a contemporary secular mentality, and open debates between proponents of religion and those of a strictly scientific view of the world seemed often to end in favor of the scientists. While some of the grand narratives, those cultural constructions that formed the shared beliefs underlying European culture, to the extent that one may speak of Europe sharing a single culture, Christianity and the centrality of human beings to the purpose of existence, for example, were being openly and thoroughly attacked. Two narratives of especial importance seemed only strengthened by modern events. Europe was more convinced than ever of its own centrality and its own power, and thus its right to dominate those different from themselves, particularly any non-Caucasian peoples, and that progress, especially scientific and technological, but by extension, progress in all areas of society, would inevitably result in things continuing to get better and better for everyone. That slowly but surely, the great Western nations would continue to advance in the direction of some inevitable utopia. World War I destroyed this illusion. Unlike World War II, where history was gifted with cartoonish villains like Hitler and Mussolini, whose bigotry, cruelty, and absurd ideology scream evil to any reasonable human being, World War I was both the war that everyone wanted and the war that no one wanted. When Franz Ferdinand was assassinated by a Serbian nationalist, Austria-Hungary saw it as an opportunity to assert itself in the Balkans. Russia rallied to the side of its Slavic neighbor, Serbia, and told Austria-Hungary to back off. And then, once Austria-Hungary and Russia came into conflict, through the series of treaties that for the past 47 years had acted kind of like a preview of the mutually assured destruction theory of Cold War international politics to preserve the peace, they instead brought everyone to the brink of war. Austria-Hungary, Turkey, and Germany, and initially Italy, were allied, according to treaty, against France, Britain, and Russia. Countless lesser military powers of Europe rallied to either side, as they were either allied or ruled by these powers. With France, Russia, Germany, Austria-Hungary, and the various Balkan states all becoming sufficiently provoked that they called for a general mobilization. That is, they set their entire military ready for combat throughout the country. It began to seem inevitable that war had to happen. Germany began the actual fighting by pushing through Belgium into France on the 3rd and 4th of August, 1914. The war would continue for just over 4 years. The Encyclopedia Britannica describes the initial European response to war as follows. The outbreak of war in August 1914 was generally greeted with confidence and jubilation by the peoples of Europe, among whom it inspired a wave of patriotic feeling and celebration. Few people imagined how long or how disastrous a war between the great nations of Europe could be, and most believed that their country's side would be victorious within a matter of months. The war was welcomed either patriotically, as a defensive one imposed by national necessity, or idealistically, as one for upholding right against might, the sanctity of treaties, and international morality. This naive embrace of war would be transformed by the horrors of what followed, with the attitude of modernism emerging from the trenches. In America, we don't really appreciate the devastation of World War I. No comparable war has ever been fought on our soil. The pictures one can see of the front and the no man's land between 1914 and 1918 appear to the contemporary viewer as if they were shots from a post-apocalyptic film or television set. In addition, while our, America's, presence on the Allied side was a key factor in victory, particularly after Russia gave up the fight following the Soviet Revolution in 1917, we suffered almost nothing compared to the major European nations. While America suffered an 8.1% casualty rate on 4.4 million mobilized troops, the total casualty rates for all troops was 57.8%, with 67.4% averaged by the losing Central Powers, and national rates such as Germany's 67.4%, France's 73.3%, Russia's 76.3%, and Austria-Hungary's astounding 90% of 7.8 million troops in the field. In Europe, whether it was strictly statistically accurate or not, the effect was perceived as an entire generation of young men destroyed by the war. As a result of this war, Germany, Turkey, and Russia collapsed as world empires. Europe and the Middle East and many other colonial regions, so-called, were redrawn to satisfy the victorious Allied powers, and the world was transformed in a bloody fit that came often to be compared to an attempt at suicide by Western civilization in the years to come. Modernism grows out of the sense of loss and lack that followed World War I. In the face of the catastrophic, horrific fact of the war and its destruction, which was viewed as the culmination of the path Europe had been on, many forces pressed for a complete break with the past and demanded that Europe face an uncertain, unknowable future, rejecting the old nationalistic, religious, and cultural narratives that had so nearly led to their self-destruction. Both because of paradigm-shifting discoveries in science, medicine, etc., that were increasingly accepted as fact by modernists, and because of their deliberate rejection of old formulas and mentalities as having led to World War I, an unparalleled spate of experiment and transformation occurred in all of the arts in the modernist period. In literature, these experiments and changes took several forms. One of the most famous, adopted by experimentalists such as T.S. Eliot, who is pictured here, Virginia Woolf, and James Joyce, was stream of consciousness narration, an attempt to do Victorian realism one better by attempting to provide a more accurate picture of the actual mental processes of the various narrators. T.S. Eliot is perhaps the first of these to attempt this style with the publication of The Love Song of J. Alfred Prufrock, but Woolf and Joyce famously followed with novels such as Mrs. Dalloway and Ulysses. An additional technique of Eliot's and others, a direct result of the modernist view of Western civilization as broken and in a sense irreparably lost, was to create tremendously elusive works that were constructed of salvaged fragments of the Western tradition, welded together in new forms. The influence of existentialism on modernist literature can be seen in the reluctance to draw clear meanings from narrative or to allow the characters of fiction to find such answers. A perhaps inevitable increase in ambiguity and uncertainty results as well. There was a growing sense of all people, but especially artists, being disconnected, divorced from each other, alienated by modernization, by the loss of the comforting worldviews that now seem to many to have been voided by World War I. Thus, there is a sense of melancholy and despair in much of modern literature, as characters search for meaning and connection in a world where meaning and connection are increasingly difficult, if not impossible, to find. In addition, the modern age, with the expansion of public education, national newspapers, magazines, and radios, ever-spreading technology, such as the telephone, and ever more mobile populations, modernism does see the arrival of the affordable automobile as well, developed for the first time a truly national society. During the modernist period, one could speak of national popular culture and national consumer trends, etc., really for the first time. The growing educated public was increasingly separated philosophically from the educated elites, and for the first time had the means to produce, preserve, and purchase their own preferences for stories, art, music, etc. Thus, the split between high and low art as we encounter it today first emerges in the modernist period. It seems undeniable that there is an element of snobbishness to the elite modernist mentality, a desire to attack the growing mass culture and mass consumerism of 20th century Great Britain. A part of the mentality behind the experiments of the modernist period was a desire by these artiste authors and artists to separate themselves from the general reading public as being separate, higher, and better than they were. In fact, among modernists, both in Britain and America, they found financial as well as critical In fact, among modernists, both British and American, who found financial as well as critical success, the authors inevitably developed a defensiveness against having sold out to achieve a widespread reading public. These attitudes of modernism, that real literature is for serious, highly educated readers and not for the general public, that a devotion to the real world and a world that is uncertain and lacking in truth or meaning, a world where it is hard to connect with people, if you can connect at all. A lot of these suppositions have stayed with us as definitions of good literature even until today. The bias in the literary community against more popular forms of literature, such as you would find in the mystery, science fiction, fantasy, or romance sections of a bookstore, are all indications of the continuing influence of modernism and its theories and thought on us.